Oh. Testing. Testing 1, 2.
I realized I
forgot to test this.
Let me do a little mic test.
During my high school graduation, a student with cystic fibrosis walked the stage right before me. He'd been in and out of school for years, naturally, because of his condition, so everyone stood up in the auditorium and applauded him. Then everyone immediately sat back down disappointedly whenever it was my turn to walk right after him. But that's not even all of it, because when I walked, I went through what I will call character development, and no, it was not me just tripping across the stage or anything like that, because that would have been too generous.
All right, were you able to hear all of that? Hopefully. I did get this mic because for months I know my audio has been a little poor, so I really hope this helps. I'm so sorry for it taking this long, but hopefully the audio becomes much better throughout my future videos, including this one. So yeah, grab a drink and get cozy and we'll get started. Hey everyone, it's Alex, and for today I actually have two book reviews that I thought was a great contribution to my reading journey, since I think these two books really talk to each other, with it being great luck that I read them so close to each other. Infinite Country by Patricia Engel follows a Colombian American family as they try to reconnect over a span of time. And Oh Beautiful by Jung Yoon, which actually comes out in November of this year, follows an Asian American woman returning to her hometown in North Dakota. Most interestingly, both Engel and Yoon are children of immigrants, with their parents having traveled here to the United States. And with both of their books, they not only have protagonists that identify the concept of the American dream, but most interestingly, I think they have some self-awareness to the apathy of the concept of the American dream as well, and whether or not their efforts are on the basis of having this conscious decision of denying the dream, or possibly on the basis too that they feel like they never even have access to it, still acknowledging how relevant it is and perhaps even necessary because of having very specific markers in their lives that maybe even made the choice for them, in a way creating a template of their own version of the American dream that still does not even service or reward them. Even if we feel that our imagination is meant to reward us in fantasizing this reality that we desire. And with the folly being not having not attained the dream at all, but the idea that the dream cannot be passed down generationally to be aspired toward. And in my frenzy of thinking of all this stuff on like a weeknight just for fun, the cherry on top is probably a few days ago, or maybe earlier this week, an article from Book Riot came out about decolonizing literary fiction, and how with contemporary fiction like Infinite Country, and I would say also Oh Beautiful, since the article does mention Infinite Country, that there is clearly more of this demand from readers of having these more diverse stories that really reflect more about who the American people are. Also, no doubt on the basis too of how much social and racial justice has grown in trying to seek that empowerment through outlets like social media. Also because of how continuously unevolved our justice system appears to be here in the States, at least. And overall, I just think there's more of a desire for people to be reading stories that they understand are about people that are not like them. As evident, especially I would say, of the cultural touchstone in a way that has become the anti-racist reading list. And definitely now I think that readers are going to be holding, if not already probably, publishers more accountable for releasing more of these diverse stories. For me, in Infinite Country's case, me having never read a story about undocumented people before. And starting off with talking about Infinite Country, we follow more of a family than I would say than a sole protagonist. We open the story with a teenage girl named Talia, who we know is in Colombia, escaping a correctional facility where she just assaulted someone, but they were trying to assault her. So to put it short, Talia is a bit of a baddie. But throughout Infinite Country, we do learn how Talia became to be in her situation, both like through story concepts like that, but also quite literally, since we get some background on Talia's parents too. We learn about Elena and Mauro as they both try to flee Colombia to have a more prosperous life in the United States. And I would say really it's no secret that Engel is trying to write this sort of placeholder of this family as being a larger gesture to talk about how hard logistically it is to just organize trying to immigrate your life to somewhere like the United States. But it's really successful in the emotional threads of even really just that phrase undocumented, how that's used as a symbol of really having no any like unique sort of presence in defining who you are, not even by your name, but just on your status. And there is a part where Engel sort of breaks the fourth wall in acknowledging sentiments like this, which normally I would feel as being unwelcomed in a story, but where and how it was placed I thought was really successful. Because what Engel does so well through characters like Talia, Elena, and Mauro, and other characters as well, is that I did feel this sense of accountability of the experiences they were facing, not even if it was up to me for how their lives were progressing with how they wanted to succeed in America. But just how masterfully Engel is at crafting these scenarios in which these characters may have successes, but they always feel tinged with this bittersweetness. Success always feeling like an exchange of something having to be sacrificed. And to me, this is painted well, or probably the best, or what I appreciated the most, through our very demure but confident wife and mother that is Elena. As I really felt, I got a sense of her both respecting and abiding by the mythology of America, but also challenging its seductive qualities and what makes it what it is. As I felt like Elena, not only through how Engel writes her so intimately in a way that reminded me a lot of reading a Ferrante character, which is already a great sign to me, but with the examples that I did have on the basis of Elena observing things like 9/11 happening in the United States and thinking of back in Colombia of how violence is equated there, or how Elena gives birth to Talia and then an American nurse talks to Elena and says, why would you have more children that you know you can't take care of? Which feels very like, again, the ideas behind individualistic and collectivist societies based on very Western perspectives that the States has. And it's because of these experiences that Elena has in ultimately having Talia go back to Colombia whenever she's a baby that positions both Elena and Talia in this sort of default configuration of Talia understanding what the dream can mean for her, as we do find her in the beginning of the story trying to meet Mauro at the airport to fly back to the States to meet her mother and the rest of her siblings after so many years. In a way, Talia's conception of the dream being very much about ideas like family and reunion. Again, acknowledging it can also be about sacrifice and privilege of what she's leaving behind, like Colombia and also her father. Which leads me to say, talking about my definitive take on Infinite Countries, that I really liked it, and I find it's one of the most impressive fiction books I've read in quite some time. The story is paced really quickly because it is really plotty, but I feel like Engel really knows how to rein in giving her characters enough development to make it feel like the reason they feel sometimes sidelined is because their focus is always on accomplishing maybe this generalization of what many people consider the dream of successfully making it back, or again, Talia's sense of reunion and family towards those American ideologies. And overall, how I was left with the impression that this family felt even more American than many American families I could think of, with how much you could tell they just loved and desired to be with one another and have that connectedness. And because of reading this, I think I just started it and realized I was liking it a lot. I picked up Undocumented Americans by the author, I can't remember, but I'll put a picture here. So I'm really excited to read more stories about this, but I know Undocumented Americans is nonfiction, so I'll be really curious to see what I make of that. Meanwhile, by comparison, we have Eleanor in Oh Beautiful, who, like I said earlier, is returning to North Dakota in her hometown whenever she used to be an ex-model. As Eleanor refamiliarizes herself with North Dakota, she realizes how much she's really changed. As the book is mostly concerned, I'd say, on the basis of how women can be conscious to how their existence matters whenever set within the gaze of men, and treating North Dakota as this caricature of small town America and what that represents to feeling American. In this case, the book definitely trying to comment on the absence of small town America, not including people of color mostly. But I would say that the book is really Eleanor's take of her impression of feeling most strongly toward how she realizes men lack this self-awareness in their privilege, predatory practices, and misogyny. And if that sounds like a bold claim, that's because Eleanor makes bold assumptions. As even beyond men, Eleanor does sort of cast off this judgmental presence of describing her hometown people as roughnecks, which I would closely relate to, maybe if anyone's heard of rednecks. And with Eleanor's growing vocabulary of how I was getting used to her, I saw her less as this sympathetic character and more as just someone being super judgmental. And why I think this is so interesting, or at least at first what I thought might have been rewarding, is on the basis of Eleanor being this Asian American woman, and she feels like that's already why people may be wary of her. But then it could also just be that she's trying to retain this sense of superiority of having fled from her hometown. That makes her feel like the authority on painting these people as how she sees them. And unfortunately, this was fine as like a few examples in the beginning of the book, but the rest of the book does become this volley of just constant misunderstanding, and how the relationship between men and women especially seem to be rooted in just sex and intimacy. As Eleanor's growing thesis about her small town is that men there are aggressive towards women because women choose to stay in their small towns. And I would disagree with that, of course, because that's so specific and there are a lot of underlying factors as to why people choose to stay in their hometown. But we know there's some context on the basis of Eleanor revealing to us that her mother actually left her own family, leaving Eleanor with her siblings and her father within their hometown in North Dakota, while her mother mysteriously went to go live her own life. So I would say clearly because of this, it sort of sets these expectations of Eleanor's relationship with men too, but also her relationship with being an Asian American woman, much like her mother having immigrated to the States for a better livelihood in herself. So thematically, I thought all of this stuff was great, but it just turns out that the execution was mainly poor, mainly because I just felt like Eleanor was being a horrible, like trendy, unlikable character in some ways. So knowing all of this about Eleanor between her relationship with her hometown and also her family, I think in a way I'm giving her more credit than I think she deserves in her possible self-awareness, especially tied to the concepts again of denying the American dream. Because while she's pretty active at deciding she's rejecting her hometown of North Dakota, mainly because she doesn't feel it's possible people there can have the progressive politics that she apparently does. Another factor I considered is that possibly Eleanor feels this way as a projection of her previous status as being this ex-model, imagining her status as a model being this stand-in for basically her way of creating this persona of how she's meant to be perceived. Perhaps at this relentless back and forth with her memory that she does in the book, which really pulls me out of the story, where she makes these random gestures towards remembering how she felt displaced at her Asian Americanness whenever she was younger. So while Eleanor does acknowledge the ability of how the American dream is not attainable for everyone, in this case her way of trying to attribute being a model as a stand-in of being purely American, or at least the American woman. Ultimately, Eleanor's downfall is that she does seem plagued by what I would call this well-intended wokeness, in how people orient their justification of who does and who does not benefit from the American dream by accidentally creating pitfalls in the conversation. Because of Eleanor having this authority that she apparently has in knowing her hometown and in ways knowing herself, but still having enough of that self-awareness to want to grow to be kind of maybe a better person, Eleanor's observations ultimately lack this sense of intersectionality. And I think actually that's mainly less about Eleanor as a character, but mainly because by comparison, Jung Yoon's way of trying to craft these secondary characters is unfortunately very paint by numbers. As the characters other than Eleanor, I would say, are very uninspired and are always placed in these cartoonish situations. And there's one truly laughable part in fiction that I've read in I don't know how long, where Eleanor literally is meant to have this epiphany or an awakening of like what felt like first wave feminism or something. She's on a phone call and she is trying to sound like really self-assured and like, you know, a girl boss. And she says, I'm gonna go to my hometown and I'm gonna write about women and, oh yeah, about race too. She literally says it like that. She says it so like revolutionary and, oh, it was so hard to read. And as you suspected, there is a lack of clear, meaningful change as to how Eleanor plans to do that. And also on the basis too of the story feeling like it becomes full circle, as we get reintroduced to a character that we meet in the beginning that comes back in the end. That felt so sitcom-y and I was just so glad when it was all over. Anyways, what I had wished instead was clearly more of the focus of the story, and what I think could have even been even slightly redeemable is that Eleanor, I think really, like at a base level, is an interesting character to have read about, but I think I wished she had focused more on the absence of her mother and how that really haunted her. And how Eleanor, I think, really has these projections of this imagined ideas of maybe what her mother was looking for that her mother couldn't find in having a family, and how maybe for Eleanor's mother, having a family or even just being around Eleanor made her feel less American than what she was searching for. And what gets in the way, perhaps, of Eleanor being this possible complex character is that well-intended wokeness I mentioned earlier, how I feel like she's earnestly trying to get there, but she just isn't connecting how a lot of her ideas are coming from, possibly the feeling of the American dream not necessarily being attainable both professionally through her modeling career, but how the American dream can have these micro impressions of how much we doubt the power of family, and how even if family is a very American sort of construction, or at least the expectations of the nuclear family, especially within small town America like North Dakota, it feels like Eleanor has to get to that first before she, you know, tries to dismantle the oppressiveness of institutions and like sexism and stuff like that. In my imaginary like sequel reading of this book, if Eleanor were to exist beyond where the story ended, I think she could actually get there. And I think if Jung Yoon would have just crafted the story more within those ideas, I think I would have liked it way more. And that does it for my reviews of both these two books. And I would definitely say I feel much more inspired to read more like immigrant fiction, if that's the appropriate term. I know that Book Riot article mentioned books like Dominicana, which I heard was pretty buzzy. But yeah, this is kind of like how I feel whenever I first read Jhumpa Lahiri. So I kind of want to go back to her other works too and pick up on those. I think even if I didn't like Oh Beautiful at all, I do like how rewarding both of these reading experiences were for me on the basis of thinking about things like this with the American dream. Which actually reminds me that I know Claire, like a few months ago, she did a Great American Dream video, like with Great Gatsby, which I'll probably rewatch now since it's been a while, like getting a high from the thoughts that I talked about here today. So if American dream fiction or whatever is interesting to you, I would definitely recommend watching Claire's video, and I'll link it down below. Otherwise, as always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.